You're listening to the audio production of Van Gogh Has a Broken Heart, What Art Teaches Us About the Wonder and Struggle of Being Alive, by Russ Ramsey, published by Zondervan and read by Kaleo Griffith. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider. It contains images, Appendixes 2 and 3, and a selected bibliography, and will be referred to throughout as the enhancement. For my faithful friend, steward of beautiful words, Andrew Peterson. Foreword. In her 2002 film Frida, Julie Taymor, known for her exquisitely visceral and brightly colorful movies, recounts the life of the Mexican painter Frida Kahlo, 1907 to 1954. The Frida we encounter in Taymor's telling is a fiery, indomitable figure despite her many setbacks. As we witness early in the film, Frida suffers from the effects of polio as a child, and then at 18, is severely injured in a bus accident that fractures her pelvic bone and punctures her uterus, robbing her of any chance to bear children. This represents only the beginning of a lifelong struggle with pain. Brought to life in an Academy Award-nominated performance by Salma Hayek, Frida aims to make sense of the many traumas of her life through art. The experience of multiple miscarriages, the struggle with alcoholism, recurring bouts of marital unhappiness, depression, loneliness, chronic pain, and the amputation of her right leg due to the spread of gangrene throughout her body, all of these afflictions served as the context in which she produced some of her greatest work, in a style that has been described as naive surrealism and magical realist. Her paintings from this period of life include The Broken Column, 1944, Without Hope, 1945, Tree of Hope, and The Wounded Deer, 1946, each a visual testament to the torment of living in a profoundly broken physical body. Experiencing in her flesh what she called centuries of torture, at one point in the movie, Frida turns to Diego Rivera, her off-and-on-again husband, and bitterly quips, "I want you to burn this Judas of a body. Burn it." Pain, for Frida, served as the cantus firmus of her life. Some of that pain was caused by a sin-fractured heart. Most of it was caused by being born into a very broken world through no fault of her own. In the final months of her life, Frida spent most of her free time drawing skeletons and angels in her diary, an ominous portent of her imminent death. Her last entry in her diary records these words: "I joyfully await the exit, and I hope never to return. Frida." She died at the age of 47 on July 13, 1954. Less famous in life than posthumously, and struggling constantly to make a living from her work, Frida nonetheless became, according to the Tate Modern, one of the most significant artists of the 20th century, the first Latin American artist to break the $1 million threshold with the sale of her painting Diego and I, and so beloved by her home country that in 1984, they declared her works part of the national cultural heritage. In the United States, she became the first Hispanic woman to be honored with a postage stamp. And 17 years later, in 2018, Mattel unveiled a new Barbie doll of Kahlo in celebration of International Women's Day. One of the reasons for Kahlo's popularity, as the art critic John Berger sees it, is owed to the fact that the sharing of pain is one of the essential preconditions for a refinding of dignity and hope for many in our society, especially for those who may find themselves on its margin. In Kahlo's life, art and anguish are intimately and integrally related. In Frida, Alfred Molina's Rivera describes her work as acid and tender, hard as steel and fine as a butterfly's wing, lovable as a smile, cruel as the bitterness of life. I don't believe that ever before has a woman put such agonized poetry on canvas. Art shows us back to ourselves, writes Russ Ramsey in this superb follow-up to his book, Rembrandt is in the Wind. And the best art doesn't flinch or look away. Rather, it acknowledges the complexity of struggles like poverty, weariness, and grief, while defiantly holding forth beauty. This is a story, he argues, that needs to be told, because it is far too easy to perceive our suffering as a kind of failure in life rather than as a means of grace, as an obstacle to get over and around as quickly as possible, rather than as an occasion for the broken beauty of Christ to be slowly but surely formed in us. Why are we so drawn to sad stories? Ramsey wonders out loud, homing in on the heart of his project. We're drawn to them, he answers, because they prepare us for what's coming. They remind us, he writes, that we are not alone in our pain. Such stories tell us that these sorrows we experience, which can leave us feeling so isolated, are in fact well-traveled roads. While Ramsey's book isn't a sad book, it is, nevertheless, a book full of sad stories. Why does this matter? In particular, for those of us who may feel a pressure to ignore them or to get through them as swiftly as we can manage. It matters, Ramsey explains, because this is where much of the world's art is born, from struggle and sorrow. Artists, as Ramsey shows us throughout his poignant work, are especially equipped to prepare us to face our own struggles with humility and to feel our own sorrows deeply without being undone by them, and to feel the possibility of hope, not just on the other side of our sorrows, but also in the very middle of them, as the trees that show up in Frida Kahlo's paintings suggest symbolically. In painting her sorrows, Frida Kahlo not only sought to make sense of the often senseless in her own life, but she also made space for viewers to find their own tragic sorrows, seemingly irreparable losses, and various experiences of rejection or loneliness named and dignified. Her life story gets retold on canvas and thereby becomes all of our story. Her pain becomes memorialized in pigment, line, texture, and color, and then again on the silver screen in Taymor's Frida, and thus fixes before our eyes an image of the possibility of hope and wholeness. If it is true, as Flannery O'Connor once wrote, that a story is a way to say something that can't be said any other way, then Ramsey gives us here a collection of stories, of Doré and Degas, of Gauguin and Gentileschi, that together convey a truth that can only be revealed properly in this way, namely, that our sorrows are ultimately hallowed by the one who enters fully into the painful stories of our own lives in order to show us that our suffering matters, while also becoming the place from which the Spirit enables us to become agents of God's healing grace to those who find themselves lost and alone in their griefs. This is a story that never gets old, and it is one that Ramsey tells beautifully throughout. W. David O. Taylor, Associate Professor of Theology and Culture at Fuller Theological Seminary, author, Prayers for the Pilgrimage, and Open and Unafraid. Chapter 1. Something Utterly Heartbroken. Gustave Doré and the Beauty of Sad Stories in a Complicated World. Have you noticed yet that the old cab horses in Paris have big, beautiful, heartbroken eyes? Like Christians, sometimes. Vincent van Gogh, Letter to Theo van Gogh and Jo van Gogh Bonger, Saint-Rémy de Provence, Thursday, 9th of May, 1889. I call him Vincent. I have ever since I was a teenager. It's hard not to. My high school art teacher taught us to love art by loving art in front of us, She had her favorites: Georgia O'Keeffe, Frank Lloyd Wright, Edward Hopper, and especially Vincent van Gogh. For her, O'Keeffe was O'Keeffe and Hopper was Hopper, but van Gogh was Vincent. Always Vincent, like he was more than one of her favorite painters. He was a person in her life, a friend. When she taught art history, she seemed to go to this other place when she started talking about the artists she particularly loved, as if she were trying to give us information that was very precious to her, while also trying to hold something back. Though I couldn't express it at the time, there was something protective in the way she spoke about them. It was like she knew their secrets, or that she loved them in a way that called for some measure of discretion. I noticed this about her, but didn't think much of it as a teenager. What 16-year-old would? I just figured these artists produced the paintings and designs she liked to look at the most. But her care in how she handled their names and stories was about more than that. And I know this now, because I took to heart her wise advice about how to cultivate a lifelong appreciation of the arts, which I will now share with you. Here's what she said. Find an artist you connect with, and then pay attention to them for the rest of your life. Read articles and books about them. Go visit them in museums. When you do, they will introduce you to their friends and mentors, the others hanging beside them in the gallery, and the artists they mention in the descriptions on the wall beside the paintings, some of whom may be just down the hall themselves. Soon you'll get to know their colleagues and heroes too. Do this, and you won't just get to know their art. You'll get to know them. For me, it was Vincent. I wasn't sure what it was that I loved about his work, but I was so drawn to it. His blues and yellows, his thick application, the motion in his compositions. If you had asked me then why I favored his work, I probably would have said I liked it because it was cool. But the truth is, I didn't know why, because I didn't know him yet. 3 decades later, I now know. It's the sadness that runs through his work, and it's the beauty he found in everything. His paintings are not mere pictures of rivers, sunflowers, or night skies. They are his attempt to capture the wonder and struggle of being alive. Everything he saw was full of beauty and sadness, an increasingly familiar tension for him. They were present even in the way he described the ordinary scenes he wanted to paint, like this description of a bridge in Arles, France. I have a view of the Rhone, the iron bridge at Tancatay, where the sky and the river are the color of absinthe, the quays a lilac tone, the people leaning on the parapet almost black, the iron bridge an intense blue, with a bright orange note in the blue background, and an intense Veronese green note. One more effort that's far from finished, but I'm trying to get at something utterly heartbroken, and therefore utterly heartbreaking. Much of the world's great art comes from places of sadness, and I believe that's often why we connect with it. It isn't that the works themselves are of a sorrowful subject matter. It's that the artists bring their personal experience to their work to say something meaningful about the world to the viewer. We want what we say to matter. We want it to connect. We want it to help people. So artists create not just to show us a picture of a bridge, but to show us something of this world where bridges are necessary and are used by people to get from one bank to the other without going under. Some cross alone, while others walk hand in hand as the sun dances on the water and casts those leaning on the rail as silhouettes. But there we are, each living out our unfolding stories that are filled with all kinds of joy and difficulty. Art shows us back to ourselves, and the best art doesn't flinch or look away. Rather, it acknowledges the complexity of struggles like poverty, weariness, and grief, while defiantly holding forth beauty, reminding us that beauty is both scarce and everywhere we look. In its scarcity, beauty often surprises us. She walks into the room in her dinner dress, and every head turns. but it is also everywhere if we will just pay attention. It's in a child's laugh, in the watercolor sky of the setting sun, and in the aroma of baking bread and brewing coffee. Beauty pulls us upward towards something that calls for some measure of discretion, something to be treated with dignity and care, something sacred. What does it pull us toward? The truth that we were made to exist in the presence of glory. But as with Moses hidden in the cleft of the rock, true glory is often more than we can bear. This world is filled with sorrows we cannot avoid. How are we supposed to navigate the tension between glory and sorrow? In this book, I, like Vincent, am trying to get at something utterly heartbroken, and therefore utterly heartbreaking, the wonder and struggle of being alive. This book is for those of us who need the bridge. There's darkness in these pages, but there's also light, and the light is everywhere. The Burial of Sarah. This is a book of stories, each of them filled with beauty, and most of them sad. It's not a sad book, but what story doesn't have some measure of sorrow? And what great story doesn't contain great sadness? Let's start with an old story filled with both wonder and sorrow, and ask why we're drawn to the sad ones in the first place. The entire time Abraham lived in the land promised to his descendants, he never owned so much as an acre, nor would he, until he bought the cave in the field near Machpelah for his beloved Sarah. If the defining moments in Abraham's life were captured as paintings, each image would be of a place miles away from the one before and the one to follow. Each canvas would depict a journey with ever-changing geography, people, and struggles. But there was one constant for Abraham every step of the way: his wife Sarah. Lovely and dignified, filled with passion and imagination, she bore her husband's burdens as though they were her own. The journey they were on was as much hers as it was his, and Abraham loved her for it. By the time we meet Sarah, she's already old. Her story is a race against time, with both the promise and improbability of bearing children following her from Ur to Canaan. She ages before our eyes as she proposes Hagar to her husband as her surrogate, an offer he accepts far too easily for her liking. She surrenders time as she tries and fails to accept Hagar's son Ishmael as part of her own family, and the boy proves that the problem of her and Abraham's infertility does, in fact, lie with her. Yet she miraculously becomes pregnant at the age of 90 and gives birth to Isaac, laying her body down a little more. Abraham and Sarah loved Isaac and clung to him like a promise from God. So on the day Abraham came to tell Sarah about his most recent visit from the Lord, the look of vacant grief in his eyes told her that whatever they had discussed, it involved her beloved son, the one they called Laughter, and it was not happy news. God wanted Abraham to do what? He went to where he kept his knives. How could he choose? Did he study their length? The truth of their edge? Did he pick each one up, comparing their heft and balance? Was the one he chose heavier than he remembered? Heavy as a stone? Abraham and Isaac ascended the mountain alone. Sarah stayed back. She feared she would never see the boy again. Several days later, when she saw them return together, both alive, she wept. Sarah died at the age of 127. Abraham went in to mourn for Sarah and to weep for her. She was the keeper of his secrets and one who spoke to him in ways no one else ever could. She was a miracle, a wellspring of life when all hope seemed lost. She was his traveling companion. She listened to his dreams and his descriptions of what it was like talking to God. She received the wounds he inflicted on her when the limits of his character were tested. When Abraham and Isaac disappeared over the horizon on their way to Mount Moriah, She prayed with the
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.